seminar because we've been running since 2021 seminars every month, but they're always online, so a very special occasion. And for me, it's very special because I am with almost a family member, I would say, Virginie. We actually had exactly, or not exactly, we had a very similar training and we share the same PhD supervisor in physical volcanology. So that's why I'm saying this is almost family. And today,
we have just been
yeah, and we also are developing a joint project with the Center for Biodiversity about all the environmental issues in Western Rwanda. So this is a process ongoing. So as you know, in Western Rwanda, we have lots of systems and the four main ones are this volcanoes, active volcanoes, the Lake Kivu, and some also an interaction with the soil in Western Rwanda. And the volcanic plumes depositing gas. Anyway, it's a very complex system, but we are building this project, this synergy project. And today, Virginie will participate on the physical part, the physical volcanology part, and talk about something which is very important for all physical volcanologists, which is where and when the magma will come to the surface. Virginie, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. And so I'm very happy to be here to do this work. And so I have to thank Catherine for inviting me. I'm going to give it in person as I was here. So we have to do it online. So, yeah. And so, so my name is Joseph Cornet, as Catherine said. And here you have my email address. So anyone is welcome to contact me. And also, I am here until the end of this week, so in case you want to reach out. Anyway, I'm going to let's do Catherine's one, so you can find me. So, I'm working at the IRB, which is the French Research Institute for Sustainable Development. And today, I will talk mainly about how computer models and also remote sensing data, which may help us to improve the volcanic risk management. And so I will talk about the new models of magma propagation, and a lot of the work that has been done with many collaborators and students, some of them are here. The work has been done in the framework of the project, it was from Magma Propagator, which I co-leaded with Eleonora Rivata from INGB in Italy. And also, I wanted to advertise that next October we will give an online course which will be given on the use of remote sensing data to improve natural hazard management. And so it will be given online. Everyone can register, so I will send the information. And so it will be given in French, English, and Spanish. So you're also welcome to follow this course if you are interested. Okay, this is the outline of the talk. I will start with a short introduction on volcanic activity and hazards. And then I will show how we can crossing bridges, but also continental reef, like here, the East African reef. It's also constructed on the subduction limits in the Andes. And we have some volcanoes just in the middle of the place, which are due to hotspots like our island, for instance. There is always around 20 erupting volcanoes on Earth, and there are around 50 to 70 eruptions per year. And what is also important is that 10% of the world population lives near an active volcano. So near, it means less than 100 kilometers from the volcanic center. And active volcanoes which have been active during the less than 10,000 years ago are considered as active. So a lot of the world population is maybe affected by volcanic activity. So this is the density of population, and you see that some volcanic areas are very highly populated. Okay, and what a bit about the volcanic activity. So mainly, so when you have an eruption, it means that the magma arrives to the surface. So magma is a fluid, it's formed by melting of solids, so mainly the mountain. Sometimes part of the crust. And it's a complex fluid, three-phase fluid, because inside the fluid you also have solids like crystals and gas. So it's a three-phase fluid, so it's complicated fluid. And okay, and so when it arrives to the surface, you have two types of activity basically, an effusive activity, that's when magma is in place at the surface with explosions. And the way it's in place is really dependent on the physical properties of the magma, and particularly on its viscosity. Because the magma is a viscous fluid, and the viscosity varies a lot, depending on the composition, the temperature, and also the gas content. Okay, and basically when you have a magma which is it's more viscous if it's more acidic. So if you have a magma which is not so viscous, like basaltic magma with a low level of silice, you will have lava flow like this. So it can flow very rapidly and affect a large area. And if it's very viscous, then it's more or less like as domes, which are maybe 100 meters large and a few tens of meters high. So, but in this case, if it's very viscous, it means that the gas may be trapped inside and you can rapidly turn to an explosive activity, which is much more dangerous usually. In this case, because the gas is pressurized, you end up with an explosion and you have particles, ash and so on, suspended in gas, and you can affect a large area. And about the possibility of volcanic risks. So this is a distribution of the fatalities depending on the various bodies. So most of the deaths are induced by PDCs, which are pyroclastic density currents, and which are produced due to this kind of activity which is explosive. So when the ash cloud fall on the volcano flank, you have what we call PDC. Okay, and that's the largest risk. And then you have also lahars. So it's formed when you have ash or unconsolidated deposits which are in place, and then you have heavy rains and it induces the mud flow, which also can be very devastating. Lava flow can also have a large impact, and you have also tsunamis in case the volcano explodes to a lake or sea, and you have this indirect stuff. I will tell you more later. Just an example for the Tbilisis. So the city of Pompeii was destroyed by this kind of activity. Explosive activity. For tsunami, we have a recent example with the Tiberia eruption in 2022. And for the floods, okay. The eruption in Colombia in 1985 was a very destructive failure. People just took the land. Okay. And so, what about the activity nearby Rwanda? So, here we are on the western branch of the East African Rift, where we have 150 active volcanoes. And so, then we have the Virunga volcanic chain along the border between BCM and Rwanda. And on the Rwanda territory, we have three active volcanoes, but very close to. You have the Nyamulagira and the Nyiragongo, which are very active and which can impact Rwanda very badly. So here you have a picture of the last eruption of Nyiragongo. It occurred in May 2021, and where the lava flow reached the city of Goma, which is more than one million inhabitants, and 1/3 of the population had to be evacuated. So, yeah. And in this case of Nyiragongo, so there had been no activity for 50 years before it started. And here you can see two satellite images, high resolution optical images, Pleiad images. So one occurred. So 2013, long before the volcanic eruption, and one occurred after the end of the volcanic eruption. And you clearly see here all the lava flow which has been placed, and this, in this case, it covers a mass of 12 square kilometers. And in this case, okay, a large part of the population here was also evacuated, and it was also destructive. Less, but still it impacted the population. And we could provide very updated information of the lava flow during the crisis, just using these high-resolution optical images. And in particular, we use stereo images. So in this case, several images are accurate, almost at the same time, but with different viewing angle. And you can use this using photogrammetry to produce a digital elevation model of the surface. So you know exactly the elevation of the surface. And then when you compare this elevation with the elevation before the event, you end up with an information on the thickness of the lava flow, which is very interesting because so you can have like with this, when you have an image, just a few hours later, you end up with an estimation of the surface, the volume, and the mean effusive rate of the lava flow, which is an important information. Okay, so it was just to show what sensing can be useful. But so in this case, it's using optical data, and you can see here all the data which were earlier during the 10 days following the start of the eruption, and only three of them, the red one, could be used because the other ones were closed. And that's the problem with optical imagery, is that when you have closed, you lose the information. But the good thing is that you can also use radar imagery, and in this case, there is no issue with the cloud coverage. And so, this is for the same area here, so here is optical data, here is the radar data. And you can use a bit the same way the radar data to map the optical deposits. And the radar data contain a lot of information because you have an information on the amplitude of the signal and also on the phase. And you can use different definition, so I will don't go into details. But basically, you can combine all this information and produce some colorized map, so colorized composition, and you are able to have an information on the ground coverage and to some mapping. And in particular, you are able to distinguish areas which are vegetated and areas which are not, and areas where new lava flow is placed and areas where which has not been affected by this lava flow. So this is the example on the Lena Gogo case. So this is a critical image, it's close. And here you see the information obtained from radar measuring using the Sentinel data, which are available free for everyone online. And so you can see that also the part which is yellow, it's a vegetated area. This part, in blue, it's area which is not vegetated, but where there is not really a new lava flow. Basically, it's an old lava flow. And here in red, it's the new lava flow. See, exactly the lava flow emplacement. So it's very interesting to have this information. Okay, so that was a bit about volcanology, but what we want to know in advance, if it's we want to know things before the event. So we would like to know in advance if the magma will reach a surface, where and when. And to have this information, we have to understand what control the magma paths and velocity at depth, when it propagates at depth. So to do so, we can use the long-term information and see the distribution of relative events and past events. So we use the information on where the magma did reach the surface in past events, and we assume that it will be probably the same in the future, and then we can have information about the trajectory. Okay, the bad thing about this is that things might change, and a lot of things might change, so and it's magma won't necessarily reach a surface at the same place. So in order to really understand, we have to take more information and to understand the physics of magma propagation. Yeah. And so when magma propagates at depth, so here is an example of eruption, it propagates mainly through magmatic intrusions. So it's just that the crust is fractured and the magma flow inside this crust, deforming the surrounding crust. And so it's in place, so the magmatic intrusions are a bit like walls, so it looks like this on the field. Usually it's less 15 centimeters large, and so it's a 3D thing, so just like a wall. So you have the largest dimension, usually the height, it's ascending. You have the breadth and the thickness. So it's really looks like a planar thing, the magmatic intrusion, and it's called dikes or seas anyway, so I will always call this dike, but it's a magmatic intrusion. And usually when we study it, sometimes we study it in 2D, so we just consider the section of the dike this way, here, considering the thickness on the height, so like the small direction. And so we really want to understand the physics behind this propagation at depth, but it's a complicated thing because we cannot see what's going on at depth. We only have indirect information. So the kind of information we have, it's mostly based on seismicity and surface displacement. So still, it's the example of the Miragongo event in May 2001. So just after the Planck eruption. And so, let's start here. So we have an information on the evolution of the surface displacement through time provided by ground instruments like GPS, for instance, and also provided by satellite imagery, radar imagery. So this is IMSA, so you combine the phase of two radar images, and you end up with an information on the displacement of the surface in the direction between the ground and the satellite. And so each French here is 3 centimeters of displacement. So yeah, you can see that's one. There are more than 8 regions that don't have displacement. Okay, and you also have the seismicity. So all these are the correlated seismicity. And as a function of time, so blue is at the beginning, and then you talk about the red and black. So you can see that the line of probability. So at depth, we miss the lake. So at some point, it stopped, it didn't reach the surface. So it was lateral probability. And okay. So all this geophysical monitoring can at depth without assembly. The question. For this, so that's why we have to understand to improve the magma propagation model. So I will just give we'll just try to explain all the factors that may control the propagation of magma at depth. So there are some factors which are due to the crust itself. So the previous image. So the magma propagation may be affected by all heterogeneities inside the crust, like faults or change in lithology. And basically, it's controlled by the rheology of this crust. And so the most important thing is the rigidity, so its ability to deform due to the magma flow, and the fracture toughness, so it might be easy to fracture the crust. And also, a key parameter is the density of the crust. And another important parameter is the local stress field, but I will just explain later what I mean by local stress field. And there are factors which are due to the magma itself. So you also have heterogeneities in the magma, because it's a complex fluid, you have gas, and the gas contents may change, the propagation and so on. And okay, we also have geological parameters. So it's also the density, but the viscosity, as I said, for surface emplacement, it's very important, but it's also very important for magma propagation at depth, because it will control the velocity of propagation, basically. And also the magma, it comes from a reservoir where you have an overpressure which will drive the propagation. So I will tell a bit more about what I mean by the local stress field. So basically, that's a force at depth acting on the magmatic intrusion. Because inside the crust, so you know that there is a force acting, and for instance, the pressure increases when you go deeper. So you have like a hydrostatic stress field. But you have a lot of things that may change or perturb this stress field, and you end up with forces which are different depending on the orientation of the magmatic intrusion. So what I mean is that you have a direction where it will be easier to open the intrusion because the compressive force applied on the surface of the magnetic intrusion will be lower. So this is just an example. If you apply a load at the surface, which is the case when you have topography, for instance, so you end up with forces or stress field which is like this. So you induce compressive forces just beneath the load. And okay, so ours are for the direction of the maximum compressive stress field, so the direction where the force is maximum. And the color map is for the amplitude of this stress field and of the minimum stress field. So basically, when you have a magnetic intrusion, you expect it, if it's controlled by the local stress field, to be open along the direction of the maximum compressive stress field, so along these arrows here, and it will open perpendicularly to the minimum compressive stress field. So it means if you have an intrusion which starts here, it will follow this arrow and reach the surface in this area. Okay, and you can also think about it in terms of energy, energy release. So basically, the driving forces for magma propagation, it's buoyancy. Because the magma is less dense than the surrounding crust, usually, so it tends to ascend, like bubbles in water, for instance. Other driving forces are basal water pressure, or a numerical model based on the Kutlai-Yamam model, which takes into account all the forces. And it has been developed by Francesco Macafferi from INGB. And takes into account this energy balance between the deformation and gravitational energy. At this point, it does not take into account the fluid flow inside. And so it calculates the directions that maximize the total energy release, and you end up with a path for the magma. And we use this to show that, okay, in case you have a topographic height, the magma tends to be attracted towards this height. And also, in case you have an unloading of the surface, like a large crater, the magma may be diverted towards the edge of this crater. And it's the case, for instance, beneath crater on the moon. So it's just to show that this can be used to predict the path. And once you have the path, once you have the path, you can use a dynamical model taking into account the fluid flow along this path to have information on the velocity. And you have to consider that the balance of the force is due to the bottom of the pressure, the density contrast, so the buoyancy, the local stress field, and the viscous pressure load. And you combine the equation of continuity and consider that the fluid flow is Newtonian, and you end up with an equation which gives you the opening of the magmatic intrusion as a function of the position of the time. And it depends on several dimensionless numbers. But we use this, for instance, to characterize the effect of the topographic load. And we show that in case the magma has a small driving pressure, so it's not so buoyant, for instance, or the overall pressure inside the storage zone is small, then the magma trajectory is really affected by the stress field, and basically it will follow the maximum compressive stress, and the magma will be deflected towards the load. But in case it has a strong, large driving pressure, it will tend to ascend vertically. And in between, it depends on this ratio. So you can have everything, but the larger the local stress field is compared to the magma driving pressure, the more important is the deflection. And this is the position of the front of the magnetic intrusion as a function of time. So this dashed line is the case where you have a vertical ascent, and you can see that the magma reached quickly the surface, and the rate of ascent is constant. But in case it's deflected, it starts to enter this area where you have a lot of compression, and it may be trapped at depth, or it's really the velocity really decreases.
Do you mean for the surface load, typically for a volcano, it's a volcanic edifice?
Yeah, it's a volcanic edifice, usually, exactly. But, okay, you can also have load effects due to ice load, for instance, when you have volcanic ice, a lot of things. But it's just an example, because the state of the stress, it depends on several things. It depends on the tectonics, it depends on the topography and so on. But it's just to show that when you know this stress field, it's possible to infer the trajectory and the path. And, okay, there is a way to somehow check these numerical models. It's to use analog experiments. And so that's usually what we do. So in the lab, for instance, it propagated 25 kilometers away from the summit. So there is an issue because this kind of event may destabilize the lake, which is full with gas, and it may induce a limnic eruption, which could be really a problem for the population living nearby.
So for this volcano, there is no PPCS, or is there any too?
Okay, the activity, I should have said that. Yeah, it's mostly an effusive activity. So with lava flow, which are, the viscosity is very small, so that they can propagate slow, propagate very rapidly.
So for this one, there's no risk of PPCS?
No.
Okay, good. It's fine.
It's not fine because the lava flow reaches a highly populated area, and also there is a high risk of gas emission around, which could kill a lot of people around. And also, there is still a plume activity. So gas and ash, which are emitted in the atmosphere, and then they fall at some distance, and also on the Rwandan territory. And this plume, so they can contaminate the air and the soil and have a long-term impact also on the people's health. Yeah, that's the kind of indirect volcanic risk. So used by ash and gas, so you have all kinds of health issues due to this effect. And in particular, there is this disease, podocolitis, which induces lots of trouble with legs like this, and it has been shown that this disease is endemic in the western part of Rwanda and in Uganda, and it has strong evidences that it's related to the fact that people are working on terrains affected by ashes. Okay, but the good thing is that it's possible to improve risk mitigation. And here you have the number of deaths, basically, as a function of time induced by eruption. And you can see that this number has decreased a lot during the two last centuries. And this is due to the development of volcano monitoring, which produces loss of life in the woods. And so that's important to develop monitoring stuff. Because before an eruption, you have some precursors. Because usually the magma is stored at depth, which will increase, and it starts to propagate towards the surface. And this induces a lot of signals, because it modifies the stress field. So it induces seismicity, it changes the gas emission of the surface, it changes the thermal anomalies, and also it induces surface displacement. All of this can be recorded and used to change the level of alerts based on scenarios. And also, you can use the stress field. So sometimes you know that the stress field evolved, and you can take it into account using physical methods.
But I think if someone may die, like 60% of the task in the they get it. And now to put which is not reliable, because if there was change in the magma, okay. The overpressure is going to change.
Okay, but still, the genetic information, they can provide some information on potential change in magnetic chamber, because change in magnetic chamber, it induces surface displacement. So still, you can have information. Yeah. I don't say that it's easy. My point is that it's always better to use this information on the physics to interpret the information. It won't solve the problem, but it will help a lot. That's my point. Okay, and yeah, a few words about the experiments. So usually what we are doing is that we are injecting a fluid like this. And this fluid, it can be air, it can be silicone oil, so we have different viscosity. And we inject it in gelatin, which is an elastic medium and which is an analog of the crust. And the good thing is that it's transparent. And so we can follow, so we inject a finite volume of fluid and we follow its propagation, so we have information on the trajectory and the velocity using some cameras from the front, to the side, and the top. And okay, the good thing is that we know very well the gelatin physical properties, so we know its density, we know its elastic properties because we can measure it very precisely. And okay, so I will just show you. Yeah, usually it depends. If it's silicone oil, yeah, we dilute it to have a better contrast. And so in this case, so we inject silicone oil, then we put a load at the surface, and you can see that it is deflected by this load. And so we have great information on the path. You want to show it again? It was just what I was explaining with the model. So in this case, it's going vertically, and once you apply the load, at some point it starts to deflect towards the load. Exactly what is predicted by the numerical model. Just because it's the easiest path to follow from an energetical point of view. Yeah. So it's very useful to have this. Experiments because it can be used to validate the numerical model.
So do you scale all the properties there to be realized?
Yeah, it's sure. So we know the density and so on, so we can calculate the buoyancy, the driving pressure, and we know the load applied, so we exactly know the stress field. So everything is gained, and you end up with this kind of path. So depending on that, the same parameters that we're using, so PM over P-load, so the buoyancy basically over the load applied at the surface. And you see that once this factor decreases, then it's more deflected. Exactly what was predicted by the numerical model. So it was very useful because also here you have the information in 3D. And in the model I was using, it was only
So the gelatin viscosity is constant through all of the...
Okay, in this case, the gelatin running PA at this time scale as an elastic solid. So there is no viscosity of the gelatin. It will be as an elastic solid. And what changed is the viscosity of the fluid we inject. And here, it's only results for air injection, so an inviscid fluid. So in this case, it really looks like the numerical results. But what we also show evidence that even if you have this ratio which is constant, there are some differences induced by the length of the crack you inject. So basically the volume you inject. And so it's not enough to consider this ratio. You also have to consider the volume of injected crack. So thanks to this experiment, we define another criterion which takes into account the temperature stress field, the buoyancy or the magma gravity pressure, and the length of the crack. but basically to an axial geographic of the volume of injected. And so you can see that for air, if this criterion is above 1.2, then you have the deflection, and the path follows the maximum compensation stress. If this criterion is below 0.5, then you have vertical ascent. So,
I think a center of magma influence they affect the erosion of the class.
Of the what?
Of the class.
Ah, okay. Why it doesn't? It changes a little bit the stress field around the tip, but it's a very local effect. But it's true that locally it affects the stress field.
Does it limit the effect of magma after changing, making some changes in the world of the region?
Yeah.
Will it increase the payload or it will lower the...
Okay, it will change. It may change the, if you have several investments of intrusions with a trapped at depth, it may change the local stress field through time. But it won't change the driving pressure for the next step. Okay, and so you can also see that when it's deflected, you have a decrease of the velocity just below the load, and it's consistent with the energy relief decrease. So you have an information in the dispositive. So you have this kind of strategy. If you know the strategy, I know it's very difficult to know this strategy. And if you know the magmatic pressure, then depending on this criterion, either you know that the magma will follow the maximum compressive stress. So either they will have a vertical ascent, and in between you will need a numerical model to estimate its trajectory. But you can answer if and where. And using the dynamic model, you can answer when. But this was for air injection. And it changed when we inject more viscous. So, for instance, in this case, we injected silicone oil, which is 50,000 times more viscous than air. And so we end up with this kind of results. That's the deflection decrease when viscosity increases. So it means that the viscosity also has an influence on the path. So it means that you cannot really do this, like calculate the path, which then you know the viscous flow, and then estimate the viscous flow along the path. You have really to have a coupled model, and that's what we just built recently within the framework of this project. So we already coupled everything, the deformation of the crust and the fluid flow. So now we take into account the forces induced by the free flow inside the crack to estimate the opening, and to estimate the energy to balance, we take into account the viscous energy due to this fluid flow. And so we end up with the velocity. And we also end up with the shape of the magmatic intrusion, which is a bit different because the crack, you have the head of the crack and still you have a tail. Because when you have a viscous fluid, it's very difficult to just close the bottom of the crack. Because very difficult to have a viscous flow and something which is very thin. So you end up with a tail like this. So we just developed this kind of model which now fully coupled the fluid dynamics and the deformation of the pod with the crust. We validated it with analytical solutions, we tested it with another model, and we use this new model. Yeah, so maybe it's already late, so yeah.
Yes, I have a question. In regards to the spinning of the Earth, that has its own spinning and is orbiting around the surface.
Yeah.
So in regards to that, we put in consideration in the way it is affecting the magma.
No, it was there's no effect on this kind of process.
Because we assume the Earth is inertial when you're dealing with this problem.
Yeah.
We assume the earth is inertia.
Yeah.
When you're dealing with this.
Yeah, we are just putting us down, smaller, at a smaller scale. Yeah. Basically, the crystal scale.
That is incorporated into the reference scale, since the question or the lake is a reference. That is
When what?
I think if the aquatic is in the ocean,
yeah.
does it affect the aquatic animals?
Ah, yeah, well, it's a completely different topic, but yeah, it may change the you will induce thermal effect, and also a lot of also contamination of the water, so it might affect. Yeah, maybe I will skip the last part because it's already definitely about the nature. It's already late, right?
Yeah.
It was there to show that you can also use the experiments to better understand the link between surface displacement and magma emplacement at depth. So I will do it quickly, so it's easy. And because in the experiments you can measure the surface displacement, either using laser scanner measurements, then you have an information of the vertical displacement of your surface as a function of time. And you can also use photogrammetry. So it's exactly the same thing we are using when we are using optical satellites, but you know, we use some cameras which are looking at the surface with different viewing angle, and so with this, processing this photograph, which are accurate exactly at the same time, we end up with a surface displacement map in the vertical direction, but also in the horizontal direction. So you have the 3D displacement field with a temporal resolution close to 1 second, and a very good spatial resolution. And so we did this kind of experiments. And as you know, you always know where the crack is in the experiments, and you know the surface displacement. So you can test the model we use to convert geodetic data, which is a good thing. So basically, we have all this information. So the position of the bottom of the car, the position of the tip, the orientation, the deep, sprite, and so on. And we test all the model we may want to test. So for instance, here we test the classical model which is used in the geodetic data, which is the Opera model, which is considering that the region is an half space, completely elastic, with uniform opening. It's the model which is the most used to invert geodetic data in the case of magma inversions. And we also tested a 3D numerical model, finite element model. So in this case, we use a realistic opening based on what we know from the numerical model of the Hartmann track. And we also tested the model we presented for the 2D propagation of the magma. And we compare the prediction of the model and the observation. So I will just show you quickly an example. So that's the case where we injected 8 milliliters of air at the bottom. And so here you have, it's always the vertical displacement. So here it's the front of the tank. Here you have the tank, so you can see where the crack is. Here you have the vertical displacement field, which is measured. Here you have the output from the numerical model. Here you have the output from the Okada model. And here you have a profile from A to B with observation in red. And the numerical model, plain line. And Okada model, the dashed line. And you start to see an uplift of the surface when the crack reach 6 centimeters from the surface. When it starts to be 6 centimeters deep, you start to see something in the observations. And then, so you see the crack is rising and the signal is increasing. So Okay, so you have this uplift, which increase. And yeah, it's very close to the surface. Yeah, it's yeah. When it's when you, it's very about to reach the surface, so the last position. So you see the observation, you have this uplift, and you see the model. So the model do pretty well in predicting the uplift, but still they do not really predict well what's going on just at above the intrusion. Because in the observation, you have an uplift above the intrusion, and in the model you have almost no displacement just above the intrusion. But in both cases, you have two locks. And the numerical model performs much better, and also the volume which is predicted is much closer to the one which is actually injected. So it's just to show that you can also use the information to, from the experiment to try to validate the tools we use to infer the shape of the magma at depth. And it's always better to use a 3D numerical model with very thick opening distribution. And so it will be always better to use a pure information on the shape, on the pressure conditions we can obtain from dynamical models. And so there is this issue for vertically propagating light, where the distribution models seem to overestimate the subsidence just above the intrusion, even for an estimator. It might be different for lateral propagating light, so we have to test it. And then we also have to inject viscous fluid just to go further. To use also this approach to develop asymmetry strategies, so that has a lot to do with the experiments. Okay? And for. Okay, the take-home message is that the local surface force strongly influence the magma path and velocity, but using a suitable model, it's possible to better interpret the geological and geophysical observation. From this, we can derive information on the stress field, on its temporal evolution. And once we have this information, we can make progress towards forecasting eruption location and time. And we end up with the presentation of the project we are trying to build with Catherine, because it's really a transdisciplinary project with a lot of pillars, so physical.
Our project, we have a soil component, okay? So, and collaboration with COED, we do some soil analysis, okay? And see if there are some minerals or contaminants which could explain that. Because it also happens, we have a strong suspicion that it happens because people, most of the farmers are walking barefoot on this soil, this volcanic soil, and that's how they're contaminated. So we will be studying this.
Another question about someone has a theory, one chart theory, say that the body was formed out of the earth, called by the singularity, but eventually sprinted to various spreads. But now I wonder if you observe the negative, some items inside.
I also want to know if there is some precautions that the pupils there can just take in order to avoid that kind of sickness.
And then you check another island, you see some of the same vegetation. I'm asking myself, is it the volcanic effect or the Pangea effect? Separation of the two.
Ah, okay. Okay. I say that the top layer is affected by the volcanic activity. Okay. Now, everything that concerns crust, lithosphere, mantle, it's more about the geodynamic, whether a continent separated is old, has never been subjected to a subduction or rifting or this kind of event. But the top layer is affected by, is built by the volcanic eruption, like lava flows, and also by the deposition of ash, okay, from the plume, okay? Good?
That's fine. Okay.